come, O Lord our God.
Pure hearts may enter into the tabernacle of the Holy of Holies through Christ our Lord. Lord, you nourish your people with food of angels and furnish them bread from heaven, ready to hand, untoiled for, endowed with all delight and conforming to every taste.
For this substance is yours to heal your children, as certain desire of him who receives it, and puts them into whatever they are each
one. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. Glory to God in the highest.
And peace to people on earth.
Lord God,
heavenly King,
Almighty God and Father,
we worship you, we give you thanks,
we praise you for your glory.
Lord Jesus Christ,
Holy Son of the Father,
Lord God,
Lamb of God,
you take away the sins of the world,
have mercy on us.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father,
receive our prayer.
For you alone are the Holy One,
and you alone are the Lord,
you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ,
with the Holy Spirit,
and the glory of God the Father.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
We ask through the same Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen. The lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass is taken from St. Paul's first epistle to the Corinthians. For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also, after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Here ends the lesson prescribed by the Church for this morning's Holy Mass.
Thanks be to God.
Lord, they all look to you to give them food in due time. Alleluia, alleluia. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me, and I in him.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Almighty and eternal God, cleanse the lips of the prophet Isaiah with a burning coal. Cleanse my heart and my lips for your gracious mercy, that I may worthy proclaim your holy gospel through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Lord be in my heart and on my lips, that I may worthy proclaim his holy gospel. Amen. The Lord be with you. Them and withdrew to a private town called Bethsaida. And the crowds, meanwhile, learned of this and followed after Jesus. He received them and spoke to them about the kingdom of God, and he healed those who needed to be cured. As the day was drawing to a close, the 12 approached Jesus and said, "Dismiss the crowd so that they can go to the surrounding villages and farms and find lodging and provisions, for we are in a deserted place here." And he said to them, "Give them some food yourselves." They replied, "Five loaves and two fish are all we have, unless we ourselves go and buy food for all of these people." Now the men there numbered about 5,000. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Have them sit down in groups of about 50. They did so and made them all sit down. Then taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looking up to heaven, Jesus said the blessing over them, broke them, and gave them to the disciples and set before the crowd. They all ate and were satisfied, and when the leftover fragments were picked up, they filled 12 wicker baskets. By the words of this holy gospel, may our sins be forgiven.
Praise be to the name of Christ.
Of faith. Nothing changes physically. The bread is the bread. The wine is the wine. but the mystery is that Jesus is there. Our faith brings us here to Mass because we believe that this is a special way of seeing Jesus and coming into his presence in the Eucharist. And now this mystery is also sacred. And this is why the focal point of our church is right there, the tabernacle. That's why you're supposed to kneel if you can before going into the pews. That's why my acolytes know whenever you cross the altar, you kneel, because that's to reverence the reserve presence of Jesus there in the tabernacle. That's why this eternal light burns, to tell us that the presence of Jesus in the tabernacle. That's why we go to confession. That's why we fast. That's why we do so many things, because Jesus amongst the Eucharist is a sacred presence. But I saw a friend on Friday. His job had taken him down to Georgia to their home office. And while there, you know, he invited someone to work out to dinner, because every time he called into the home office, this person was very, very helpful. And he wanted to say thank you. And I don't know if this is a Southern thing, but somehow over dinner, the person from Georgia decided to bring up religion. And now it may be a New Englander stereotype, but that doesn't sound out of character to me. And she boasts about how she and her daughter go to church every Sunday and how they sing in the choir. And then my friend told her, the New Englander, told her, well, I don't belong to any church. And then her Southern sermon started. You know, Jesus this and Jesus that, and, you know, damnation and all that kind of fiery stuff. And this is when he finally interrupted her, and he said, do you do anything else for God besides going to church and singing the choir? It didn't register. He said that she just kind of looked at him like with a blank stare. What do you mean more than doing that? And then he listed all the charitable activities that he actually runs, that he participates in, that he donates to, finishing off with his belief that God counted this as important too. And isn't that also the invisible presence of Christ? The Eucharist that we believe in does not give any of us who receive the Eucharist the privilege to brag about how special we are in front of others who don't receive the Eucharist. We can only boast about how special Jesus is. He makes himself available to us every time we approach his altar. And then, even more surprising to me, he's willing to lead with us wherever we go, wherever we take him, and he listens and he watches everything we do. Think about that when you leave this sanctuary. Jesus goes with you. He listens to what you say. He watches what you're doing. He is in communion with you. So, you know, you're in the sanctuary here, but what are you going to do the rest of today? What are you going to do Tuesday? What are you going to do Thursday? Jesus is with you. And his sanctity, however, is not offended by our humanity. And that's one of the blessed revelations of our faith. This past week, I shared an Old Testament story with our Bible class, and it was about Moses and the elders of Israel. They had climbed up Mount Sinai, and they were basically having a picnic with God. They sit huddled in a group by themselves, and they look upon God's glory a little distance away, and they're scared, they're apprehensive. And then there's this wonderful gem of an ancient, old, I mean ancient, as when, you know, they didn't change it in the Bible, and somehow it slipped in there. There's this ancient gem of a sentence, and it says, God did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel, and they beheld God, and they ate and they drank. They're up there having a picnic, and God did not strike them. God withheld his revulsion, and according to the story, God did not strike them dead. Why? Simply because they were there, because they were so much less than God, because they were human. God was offended by them simply because they were human, and it says with great celebration that God did not strike them dead, and they bragged about how gracious God was, that he didn't strike them dead for coming so close. And then think about our Jesus. Think about his birth story amidst poverty and animals. Remember that he spent more years as a common carpenter than he ever did as a priest. And don't forget that when he did start his ministry, it was to the ordinary people of his day, and even more extraordinarily, to the outcasts and to the ones called sinners. Think about the revelation that Jesus senses that one of his closest followers is about to betray him to death, and yet Jesus at the Last Supper shares the bread and the wine, even with his betrayer. So it's not just the 11 minus Judas that get that first Eucharist, it is all 12 of them. For in Mark's Gospel, Jesus reveals that one of the 12 will betray Jesus, and then Jesus says, it is one who is eating with me That's the picture of almost every single church at their main altar of the Last Supper. Judas is there, and that sacrament is being offered even to Judas. And then without any change of scene, Mark takes us to the words of institution and the sharing of the bread and wine, and the gospel says explicitly, and they all drank. Judas is in that picture. He's usually the one, if it's Leonardo da Vinci, he's holding that bag of money. He's at the end of the table. But no matter how bad Judas may be, no matter how horrible what he was planning to do to Jesus, when it comes his turn, Jesus does not hold the Eucharist from him. Jesus offered the Eucharist even to the one who's going to kill him or betray him to kill us. So we can't brag about receiving the Eucharist because even Judas received the Eucharist. What we have to strive for is to be worthy of it, so we can't brag about it. What we can boast about is how special Jesus is and that he desires so much to be with us, imperfection, faults, and all, but that Jesus gives him the Eucharist and all of us as well. And that's a new vision of God. That's not a God who goes up on the Mount Sinai and withholds his hand and strikes them because they're human. We have to celebrate that. This is the Jesus who offers himself even to Judas. The Eucharist is a precious gift and one seen by faith. But Jesus is present in so many other ways too, and again, seen by faith. So let today's Mass and Corpus Christi remind us of the blessing that we approach every time that we come closer to the sanctuary. Let it stand guard against coming forward casually or just out of habit and not thinking about the grand mystery that we are about to participate in. This is the mystery of faith that brings Jesus to us, and so that we and each other can come into communion with God. That we may never, ever take this sacrament for granted, may this be our prayer today. In Jesus' name, amen. In the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Almighty Lord, as we gather before your altar on this Corpus Christi Sunday, we offer you our thanks for the gift of the altar. We also offer our prayers for the health of Josephine Lisensky, as offered by the Sisters of the Adoration Society. We offer our prayers for the passing of David Rapley on May 30th, 1974, as offered by his wife, Carolyn Rapley. We also offer prayers for my father, Rudolph Calvin, who passed away last year on June 1st. This is offered by my entire family. We also continue to offer our prayers for the fallen who are battling cancer. Doug Robinson, my daughter Jenny Whitman and Karen Herzig. Meg Connors, by Ellen and Don Strosky. Brandy Clemens, by her grandmother, Dottie Baronis. Fathers Ray Draven, Jan Diocek, and Maurice Luzel. It's offered by myself. And also Frank Strosky, who's battling neurological disease. It's offered by his twin brother, Don. Strosky, Gatesby, Kirkendall families. We also offer our prayers for Mrs. Frances Mack, the mother of Bishop John Mack, who died this past Wednesday. May she rest in peace, and may God's gift of hope also remain with her family. Are there any prayers that you would like to offer this morning to the congregation? Lord, on this Memorial Day weekend, since we will be gathering for Mass tomorrow, we will hold our prayers off at that time. But we do want to acknowledge all of those who have served, especially those who have given the supreme sacrifice of dying in the line of defending ourselves, our nation, and our ideals. We always remember them, especially on Memorial Day weekend. We ask the Lord to bless each and every one of us here gathered. We ask you to hear the private prayers that we bring before you at this time. And we ask you also to those of our parish who are unable to be with us here today, and those of our parish who have chosen not to be with us here today. And for these things together, Lord, we pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. May they rest in peace.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
I believe in one God,
the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one believing Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, and he suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in fulfillment of the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will not have an end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I acknowledge my baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God.
throughout all ages of ages.
Thank you.
manner after supper, taking also this excellent chalice into his holy and venerable hands, again giving thanks to you, he blessed it and gave it to his disciples, saying, all of you take and drink of this, for this is the chalice of my blood of the new and eternal testament, the mystery of faith, which for you and for many shall be shed for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you shall do these things, do them in remembrance of me. Wherefore, mindful Lord, we your servants, as also your faithful people, in remembrance of this Christ, your Son and our Lord, as also his blessed passion, resurrection, and his glorious ascension, we receive from your own gifts and presents a pure offering, a holy offering, an immaculate offering, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of eternal salvation. These gifts we receive with a joyful countenance as from him, who is the giver of all temporal and eternal good gifts, and with an unshakable faith, they will become for our souls a saving remedy. We humbly beseech you, Almighty God, command that our prayers be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your highest altar, for the countenance of your divine majesty. That as many of us as receive this altar, the most sacred body and blood of your Son, may be filled with every blessing and grace through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be mindful also, Lord, of your servants and handmaidens, all who have gone before us with the sign of faith and who have passed on to eternity. These souls, O Lord, as also to those who died in Christ, grant everlasting life, and to those who during life strayed from the path of righteousness, unmindful of your fatherly love, mercifully short their sufferings, and beseech you, in the name of Christ our Lord, and your beloved Son. And grant us, your sinful servants, who hope in the greatness of your mercy, some part and fellowship with your holy apostles, martyrs, and all your saints, who shed their blood for your name's sake, whose hearts were always open to justice and mercy, and whose lives, patterned after the divine master, merited eternal bliss. Number us, O Lord, of their company, with confidence we ask you, not because of our merits, but that you bestow forgiveness through Christ our Lord. By whom, O Lord, these gifts you always create, sanctify, revive, bless, and bestow upon us all these good things. Through him, and with him, and in him, you, God, Father Almighty, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and all glory. Throughout all ages of ages,
Amen. Let
us pray, admonished by salutary precepts and following divine institutions, we make bold to say, that being supported by your help, may always be free from sin and secure from all despair. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son and our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, ever one God. Throughout all ages of ages, be to our sanctification and life everlasting. Amen. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, grant us peace. O Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, my peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not upon our sins, but upon the faith of your church, and grant her peace and unity according to your will, who lives and reigns, God, world without end. Amen. O Lord Jesus Christ, Son of the living God, who according to the will of the Father, through the cooperation of the Holy Spirit, has by your death revived the world, deliver me by this your most sacred body and blood from all my iniquities and from every evil, and grant that I may always fulfill your holy will, who lives and reigns for all ages. Amen. Partaking of your body, O Lord Jesus Christ, which I, all unworthy, dare to receive, may not serve as a judgment, but through your mercy may become a defense of my soul and body and a desired remedy. May this sacramental union with you, Jesus Christ, my Master and Savior, awaken in me living faith, fervent love, worship, adoration, and a holy longing. May it make me a willing and zealous servant toward fulfilling God's purpose on earth, and may it at last unite me entirely with you, Christ and God, in eternity. Grant this through this reigns of God the Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, world without end. Amen. I will take the heavenly bread, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul unto life everlasting. Amen. What shall I return unto the Lord for all the graces that he has rendered unto me? I will take the chalice of salvation, and I will call upon the name of the Lord. With high praise will I call upon the Lord, to be saved from all my enemies. May the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ preserve my soul unto life everlasting. Amen. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Lord, I am not worthy you should enter into my heart, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Body of Christ. body and the blood of Christ. Body and the blood of Christ. Body and the blood of Christ. Body.
Darkness did not overcome. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He
came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light, the true light which enlightens everyone who's coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came to being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or the will of flesh, or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us. We have seen his glory, the glory as of the Father's only Son, full of grace and of truth.
Thanks be to God.